What is a griffin? We probably all know the answer to that. It is among the most well-known imaginary monsters around the world. They can be seen in emblems, movies, games, decorations, and while their appearance often varies, it is always discernible. The head and wings of an eagle are mandatory components, as is the body of a lion. Whether the legs are avian or mammalian, and in what combination changes from image to image, and their once prominent ears are usually missing in modern depictions, but the form of a griffin is easy to identify. Where does this creature originate from? How did it come to be so widespread, inhabiting both our imagination and our environment to this day? The history of the griffin is a long one, and I most definitely do not have all the details as finding every mention of the beast in the tales of the myriad nations that adapted it into their culture is an impossible task. However, I do know its origins. The griffin is one of the oldest known monsters, featured in ancient Oriental ornaments, most prominently in the Fertile Crescent. It can be found in Egyptian and Mesopotamian art as far back as 3300 BC, spreading to nearby cultures. Such depictions can be found in Syria, Anatolia, and Cyprus, and through the changes of the Sassanid Empire and Byzantium, it found its way further west. Attesting to this is a deed of the marriage between the Byzantine princess Theophano and the Germanic emperor Otto II, in which a griffin is featured clawing at an antelope. The beast here shows its original design, with lion legs and ears, symbolizing the day, as the antelope is the embodiment of the night. Day triumphs over night, and through this and even earlier depictions we can see that, originally, the griffin was a symbol, a divine beast. Not particularly the bloodthirsty man-eater it later turned into. As an example, in Sumerian myth, the griffin was the mount of Iskur, the god of weather, particularly of rain and storm. When the land was parched, he rode his mount across the sky, and it vomited water lightning onto the ground below. What a beautiful picture. Just think about that the next time it rains. Ancient Assyrian art depicts the griffin as a protector of the Tree of Life, and often assists divine features in their fight against evil. Some were also shown with Malakbel, an Egyptian sun god. Griffins were even featured in the Pentateuch, guarding the Ark of the Covenant, but were not featured in the Christian Bible originally. The Greeks really fancied the beast, decorating vases, mosaics, reliefs, coins, seals, and even tombs. They believed the griffin was a psychopomp, a guardian and bearer of the soul, helping one's transition to the afterlife. The eagle-lion hybrid was also associated with several deities, including Nemesis and Apollo, whose chariots were drawn by the monsters, while Artemis was also dubbed the mistress of griffins. The most notable Greek debuts include King Minos' palace, built around 1700 BC. On its walls, griffins fight bulls and lions, while the beasts also line the throne room. Additionally, Aeschylus's Prometheus-bound tragedy calls the creatures the sharp-beaked, unbarking hounds of Zeus. In a 5th century BC report of Herodotus, he conveyed what Aristes of Proconnesus shared with him. According to the man, the griffins lived north of Scythia, in the Middle East, where they guarded their gold. A monstrous race of one-eyed men, the Arimaspians, stole their gold from these birds. Herodotus was skeptical about the existence of the Arimaspians and thought that the traveler was misleading him. This is especially likely since both them and the griffins were mentioned in Prometheus Bound, practically next to each other. He did believe the part about the griffins though, as by now the existence of these sharp-winged monsters was very widely accepted. Incidentally, the name we use today originates from the Greek gyphos, which means hooked or curved, referring to the beak. As accustomed to, the Romans also borrowed the griffin from the Greeks, decorating their own tombs with them. Additionally, the great mosaic of the Villa Romana della Casale in Sicily depicts animals being caught to be used in the Colosseum and the Circus Maximus. In this grand image, the only animal not caught, defiantly standing on a cage with a human inside, is the griffin, showing it to be untamable, destined to be violent and unbound. Virgil expanded the lore of the griffins by stating that this monster and horses mating would be an impossibility, since these birds not only eat but passionately hate the animal. This later led to the birth of the hippogriff, but that's a story for another time. Claudius Alienus, a 2nd century author, also wrote of the beast. He claimed that the Indian griffin dug up gold with its beak and used the ore to build its nest. Hunters often tried to steal the precious metal from these birds, but since the animal was strong enough to overcome elephants and tigers, the poachers had little chance. While there is very little evidence, griffins also seem to have entered Celtic culture. A votive cauldron was unearthed in a region that once belonged to Thrace. It featured 2 griffins, 2 elephants, and 1 feline creature attending to the goddess of the card, which is also incidentally the only recovered depiction of her. When it comes to Christian culture, there are very few early mentions. Perhaps the most ancient one stems from the Physiologus, an old bestiary written in Greek. According to the text, a griffin catches the rays of the rising sun on its wings, another one helps carry it across the sky while Saint Michael and the Blessed Virgin pray for all Christian souls, and you can almost see the picture someone's grandma posted on Facebook. When the Bible was translated from Hebrew to Greek and then to Latin in the form of the Vulgate in the 4th century, a small but very important mistake was made. One of the animals from Moses' list of those unclean and unfit to eat was mistranslated as griffin, and thus the mythical monster entered the Bible. From here on out, its existence was proven, as the Bible can hold only the truth and nothing else. As a result, the beast slowly started to filter into Christian culture. Saint Isidore of Seville, for example, was the first one to proclaim that the griffins are hostile towards horses, eviscerating them on sight. He also added that the beasts live in Hyperborea, the land beyond the north wind, and that they are attracted to gemstones and gold, guarding their hoards of treasure fiercely. All based on first-hand experience, I'm sure. Robert II, Electric Boogaloo of France, had a griffin's egg enclosed in a silver reliquary box, authentic I'm certain, and made people to swear upon it to make sure they keep their oath, lest the fury of the beast descend upon them. As did the griffins adorn the architecture of the Fertile Crescent, so did they appear on book covers as gargoyles and later on heraldry. They became an integral part of medieval Europe. The repertoire of the griffin's properties and tales kept growing. John Scotus, a 9th century Irish theologian, claimed that the beasts remain celibate after their mate dies, showing the commendable virtue of loyalty. However, other theologians dislike the creature, saying that they are greedy and, since they live in the north, faithless, uncharitable and lacking in goodness. They are unclean, therefore they are avaricious, tyrannical, cruel and a symbol of the devil. It's quite complicated when it comes to the religious image of the griffin. Some liken it to Christ, due to its dual nature possessing both earthly and heavenly elements, while others just flat out said that they are devil spawn. There were some pretty malicious and weird people back in the day, furiously hating everything that wasn't a God-fearing adult man. Something as mundane as a boar, for example, was practically the embodiment of evil to them, depicting the animal as the writer of the devil's 10 commandments. A fanatic physically harming themselves because they had a thought other than loving God? Perfectly normal. A random pig in the forest? Oh heavens, you can see it in its eyes, it wants to murder orphans and rape the bodies! Regardless of the senseless babbling of priests though, the griffin was well liked in the Middle Ages, featuring in many famous stories of the time. One tells of the time when Alexander the Great conquered India. He wished to fly off to the edge of the horizon, therefore he ordered the construction of a strange contraption. It was a man-sized cage with griffins harnessed to its sides. Alexander teased these birds with meat, and when the beasts attempted to acquire the food, they started flying, lifting the men into the clouds. However, an angel descended from the heavens, saying, "O Alexander, have you not secured the whole earth, and now you must explore the heavens? Return to earth as soon as possible, or you will become food for these birds." This adventure was very prominently featured in medieval artworks. Another story tells of an emerald, which Lucifer wore on his forehead. When he was cast down from heaven, the gemstone fell off of him. Griffins, being very fond of emeralds, acquired it and viciously guarded it until a hero found them and took the treasure. The legend says that this is the very material the Holy Grail was carved from. Prester John, a mythical Christian king of the Far East, once wrote a letter. In it, he shared an account of his subjects' interaction with the griffins. In his kingdom was a valley with jewels scattered on the bottom. People threw sheep carcasses into it, and the beasts swooped down to collect them. The gems that adhered to the wool of the sheep fell down as the griffins soared away, making an easy harvest. Interestingly, the griffin was not featured in the bestiaries of the Middle Ages until the 12th century. Even then, authors struggled where to put it. Is it a bird? Is it a land animal?
It's Superman!
Up to this point, though, its existence was undoubted. Saint Hildegard of Bingen was among the first ones to include them in her writings. She wrote that the griffins lay their eggs into caverns they can barely fit. This saves them from lions, who would trample them out of hatred when they catch scent of the nest. Even Marco Polo encountered some Madagascan specimens. He claimed that they lift off elephants and dash them to pieces from on high. Sometimes I think he was just writing down any bullshit that came to his mind to see what he can get away with. On a slightly less fantastical note, Dante's Divine Comedy also featured one of the monsters, restoring it to one of its original positions as the protector of the Tree of Life. Towards the late medieval era and the beginning of the Renaissance, the debunking of its existence began. Many naturalists and writers were very doubtful, seeing that no such animal has been encountered in their time. However, even now the beast found its defenders. Alexander Ross, among others, wrote,
"If any man say that now such animals are not to be seen, I answer, it may be so, and yet they have not perished, for they may be removed to places of more remoteness and security, inaccessible to man."
Even though we no longer believe in its existence, at least no one outside of History Channel, I'm sure they have someone looking for the griffin as well, we still prominently feature it in icons, books, movies and games, among other facets of our lives. I also found a few tidbits which I could not incorporate into the main body of this section, so I'll just dump them here. The Indian griffins apparently collect agate besides gold to add to their nest, for it has healing properties, and feed their hatchlings with human meat. Additionally, griffin claws show the presence of poison by changing color, but cannot cure it. This is about all the information you need to know about the griffin's history, but let's take this one step further. Its existence is a myth, there is no doubt about that. But theoretically, could something similar exist? The short answer is no, not without extensive changes to our natural history. The first problem we face is the same one medieval naturalists could not solve. What is it really? It cannot possibly be a cross between birds and mammals. While some mammals, like the platypus, show bird-like features, the griffin is on another level. Wings, beaks, eggs, these are all avian features, but its tail, ears and legs do not belong on a bird. Additionally, having six limbs is not really common among vertebrates. In fact, it's practically an impossibility, as mutating extra functional and symmetrical limbs, which present a competitive advantage and are consistently passed on to future generations, is extremely unlikely. So much so that it never occurred once since the appearance of the first quadruped. But in a parallel universe, there could be an evolutionary path that would be a pretty good explanation for many fantastical hexapods. Picture an early fish that evolved some extra fin-like appendages, similar in principle to the handfish. They use these mini limbs to propel themselves by walking on the seafloor, maybe even use them to hold onto rocks in extreme tidal events. As they evolve and their transition to an amphibious lifestyle occurs, their appendages grow, gaining bones, becoming part of their skeleton as actual limbs. In the new frontier of Dryland, they have an extra advantage in their third pair of legs. Not only did it grant them an edge in terrestrial movement, it also proved to be invaluable in climbing. They are among the first creatures to reach locations previously inaccessible to vertebrates, including steep elevations and the top of fern trees, being a lot more mobile than the tetrapods of the Carboniferous with their underdeveloped limbs. As time goes on and terrestrial vertebrates become more adapted to their environment, these six-limbed species respond with other developments. They grow lighter, and their extra set of limbs now have thin membranes stretching between them and their body. This helps them perform safe yet quick descents from elevations or trees, not only serving as a great defense tool, but also a means for hunting, giving them an edge over animals bound to ground movement. As time moves forward, they lose even more unnecessary weight and become the first vertebrates to take flight. While the weight of their additional limbs forces them to be smaller than the large prehistoric reptiles that rule the skies, they still have an advantage. They are a lot more agile on the ground, not nearly as vulnerable, possessing the valuable option to hunt using whichever option is best for the given state of their environment. With the appearance of early birds, animals which possess even lower weights, extremely agile and swift flyers, capable of taking off while standing still, the six-limbed creatures face their greatest challengers yet. Convergent evolution leads them to also develop feathers. They lose their teeth, their jaws turning into beaks, yet their extra pair of limbs keep them from achieving the same aerial mastery. Instead of losing them, however, they excel in other areas using their distinctive features. Even the largest birds in the air fear these beasts, as for every claw they could tear at them with, the griffins strike back with two. Tougher prey falls to the assault of the hexapod birds, and even when their wings are wounded, they can sustain themselves by terrestrial hunting until they heal. On this imaginary version of our planet, griffins are just another apex predator, perfectly plausible. The only difference we would see between these griffins and those of legend are the tail, all legs being avian, and the lack of prominent ears. While this is no more than a thought experiment, events like this are not that unlikely, and the fantasy world featuring this evolutionary path would also have explanations for dragons, six-legged basilisks, and even winged humanoids. With this, my video comes to a close. I hope I provided some information about the griffin you didn't know and that you enjoyed my evolutionary tale. If the video was to your liking, please consider subscribing and pressing the like button, as it would really help the channel gain more attention. Next episode will be another community request, the Hethaiosh for the latter age, but if you have another monster you'd like me to cover, you can leave it in the comments. Thank you for joining me on this journey. Bye!